So hello everybody. My talk is only to simulate small polaron with Abinit, so it will not be about a numerical implementation. It will be purely methodological. In fact, it will be about some specific functionalities of the code that can be used to treat small polarons with Abinit. So it will be purely methodological. My talk has three parts. In the first part, I will remind you what the small polaron is. Then, second, I will show you how to compute a self-trapped polaron using DFT, in particular with Abinit and with some specific functionalities of Abinit. And last, I will explain how to deal with the problem of small polaron hopping with Abinit. So, the context is the physics of semiconducting and insulating materials. As you know, these compounds always contain, intentionally or not, some point defects. And you can divide most of these point defects into two families. In fact, you have donor point defects, which have the capacity to liberate electrons, and acceptor point defects, which have the capacity to liberate holes. That is to say that they catch electrons, in fact. In oxide materials, typical examples for donor defects are the oxygen vacancy of the cation interstitial. And a typical example for acceptors are the cationic vacancies and the allele-valence substitution of the cation, that is to say the replacement of a cation by an element of lower valence. Okay, so let us take as an example the oxygen vacancy in an oxide, which is usually a double donor defect, which means that this defect has the capacity to liberate two electrons. So the defect can be in different charge states. First, if the two electrons remain either on the defect or very close to it, the defect is said to be in a neutral state. If one electron leaves the defect and is released in the lattice, the defect is said to be in a partially ionized state. And finally, if the two electrons leave the defect and go away far from it, the vacancy is said to be fully ionized. So the question is, how do these released electrons in blue on the right behave in the lattice? So first, they can be, of course, caught by an acceptor defect that lies somewhere else in the crystal. If not, they can be either delocalized, thus occupying a spatially extended state at the bottom of the conduction band, or localized, spatially localized, thus breaking translational symmetry of the crystal, and distorting the environment and making a so-called polaron. And if the electron is localized on a single atom, it is said to form a small polaron. The electron localized close to the defect in a partially ionized or neutral state is sometimes denoted as a bound polaron. The small polaron can thus be bound or self-trapped when it lies far from any defect. The state in which you find the defect depends on the electronic chemical potential, that is to say the Fermi level. Let us concentrate now on the electron once it has been released in the lattice. I have said that it can be either delocalized in a bound state or at the bottom of the conduction band, so this is the picture on the left, or localized as a self-trapped electron polaron, and in that case it occupies a quantum state lying in the gap and detached from the conduction band. In the case of a hole, so on the right of the slide, the delocalized hole corresponds to an empty state, this time, at the top of the valence band, and the self-trapped hole polaron to an empty state in the gap detached from the valence band. Let us focus on this electron or hole in the lattice when it is localized on a single atom, and let us examine by which mechanism this localization is possible. When you enforce the localization of an elementary charge on one atom in a crystal, you have to pay several energetic contributions, among which, on the left, the quantum zero-point energy associated with its confinement, and the atomic distortions created all around, which correspond to a kind of radial polarization of the environment of the charge. However, this cost can be compensated by a favorable interaction between the localized charge and the field of polar distortions all around. And if so, you can stabilize the small polarons. This process is called the self-trapping mechanism and can be described as a kind of self-consistent loop as follows. So imagine on the left, you force the charged electron or hole to be localized on one atom. As a consequence, this breaks the translational symmetry of the crystal and creates atomic distortions all around because the matrix is polarizable. This field of radial polarization creates an additional electrostatic potential on the site where the charge is localized and makes the electronic potential, that is to say the potential felt by this additional charge, deeper at the site where the charge is localized, and as a consequence, the localization is enforced. So this process can be quantified by the so-called self-trapping energy, defined as the difference between the total energies of the fully optimized polaronic configuration and that of the delocalized one, and if it is negative, the self-trapped polaron is stable. Let us see how to compute a self-trapped polaron with DFT and how it can be done with Abinit. So first, obviously, you have to add or remove one electron, which is done by the keyword charge. Concerning the exchange correlation functionals, the standard local and semi-local functionals are usually unable to produce a self-trapped polaron because of their trend to the delocalization due to the self-interaction error. Typically, it's better to use DFT plus U or hybrid functionals such as PB0 or HSE. Note that to simulate oxygen type Hall polarons in oxides, it can be necessary to apply a Hubbard term on the p orbitals of oxygen. So in practice, the physical problems you can encounter can be the simulation of a small polaron alone in a supercell, so isolated in a large supercell, the simulation of a small polaron close to a defect, a domain wall or something like that, or the hopping of the small polaron from a site to another. For that, you may want to choose the atom and the orbital on which the small polaron is localized. You can enforce this manually by modifying the distances to first neighbor atoms, for example, but this may be not sufficient to choose the orbital on which you will localize the polaron. So fortunately, Abinit has a powerful functionality related to the DFT plus U. It is possible to constrain over a given number of electronic steps, either at the first ionic steps or at all ionic steps, the occupation matrices of the correlated orbitals. Thus, you can impose at the beginning of your calculation on which atom and in which orbital you put your additional electron or hole. This can be done by the following two-step procedure that I illustrate here with, in the case of an oxygen type Hall polaron in an oxide. You can see the picture on the left. First, you create the self-trapping distortion. For that, you enforce the localization on a given atom and given orbital. So here, this is atom A and orbital PX, and structurally optimize the system by constraining the occupation matrices over all the electronic steps and all ionic steps. Then, starting from the obtained geometry, you release the constraint of fixed occupation matrix. So in fact, you impose it only at the first ionic step. And then terminate the structural optimization. After that, normally you obtain your self-trapped polaron on the atom you have chosen and in the orbital you have chosen, provided, of course, that this self-trapped polaron is stable. So a few words now on how to choose the Hubbard parameter to simulate a self-trapped polaron. So as you know, the Hubbard parameter is usually chosen to reproduce the bulk properties of the system, such as the band gap, or it can be also directly calculated ab initio. In the case of a small polaron, it can be interesting to choose the Hubbard parameter, to cancel as much as possible the self-interaction error. So the idea is, since a small polaron consists in adding an elementary charge to the system, to examine how the energy varies when adding this charge, but little, by fractional values. In theory, the energy should vary linearly as a function of the number of electrons between two consecutive integer values. So you can adjust the Hubbard parameter to reproduce as much as possible this piecewise linearity of the energy as a function of the fractional charge. So in practice, you take and freeze the polaronic configuration, and you compute the total energy by varying the keyword charge from 0 to plus or minus 1 by fractional value. So little by little, you do that for several values of the UBART parameters, and you retain the one that best corresponds to the linearity. Oh, sorry, there, I have a problem here with the, okay. So this can be seen here. So here, for example, the best U should be around 7.5 EV on the left here, and 4.5 EV on the right here. If you do not use this ideal U value, this best U value, you can, of course, compute a self-trapped polaron, but you may not obtain the good self-trapping energy. So I now show you one example. This is a study of oxygen-type Hall polarons in barium stannate. These Hall polarons appear under acceptor doping. Here, the replacement of one tin by an atom of lower valence, such as yttrium or gallium. Using the procedure explained above, it's possible to simulate a small polaron at different distances from the dopant. So here you have the polaron as the first, on the first, an atom first neighbor of the dopant, and here an atom second neighbor of the dopant. And thus, to compute the dopant hole interaction energy as a function of the ionic radius of the dopant, you can see that for small dopants, so for example gallium, the Hall polaron is the most stable as the first neighbor of the dopant, but for the largest one, for lanthanum here, it is more stable as second neighbor. So the interaction between the negatively dopant, the negatively charged dopant here, and the positive Hall is not only a question of electrostatics, but also a question of elasticity. So my last part is about small polaron hopping and how to simulate it. So first, remember that small polaron hopping is a thermally activated process, but in which the thermal energy necessary to overcome the barrier is provided by the atoms and not by the electron or the hole, which remains in its ground state. So the polaron transfer is a tunneling process that takes place in specific configurations, which are usually called coincidence configurations. And in this configuration, the charge would have the same energy if localized on the initial or on the final site. There are two limiting cases. If the tunneling time is smaller than the coincidence time scale, the hopping is said to be adiabatic, if not, said to be non-adiabatic. And under the assumption that the transfer is adiabatic, the hopping can be simulated by the Nudge elastic bound or by the string method. So in Abinit, with DFT plus U, once again, the computation will be made easier by the fact that the occupation matrices can be constrained for each image, and you just give them, if you just give them for the first and last image, a linear interpolation will be applied. So here is an example for different kinds of hoppings concerning the oxygen type polaron in barium stannate, from which I have already talked well. You see that the different mechanisms here are all associated with energy barriers, and the progressive transfer of the polaron can be observed by the evolution of the magnetic moment on the initial and final atom. And here you have an animation of this simple hopping mechanism. And when you are at the top of the barrier, you can see on the left the coincidence configuration in which the polaron is exactly equally shared between the two atoms, the initial and the final one. So as a conclusion, some functionalities of Abinit related to DFT plus U can be used efficiently to simulate small polarons, in particular the possibility to constrain the occupation matrices of the correlated orbitals. This allows to build a systematic procedure to localize the small polaron on given atom and in a given orbital. And this can be used to find, for example, the most stable state for a polaron, or study an interaction between a polaron with a defect and so on, and to compute hopping path. So I want to thank Bernard Amadon, Guilhem Dezano, Charles Payer, and Brian Keel, who are involved in the studies I have mentioned. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Grégory. So I think everybody recognized the picture that we have when we opened the website, abinit.org. So now we know what it is. I have a question for you, because you did not mention the charge corrections, and polarons are localized, so I guess you need to correct the total energies you obtain from Abinit.
Yes, absolutely. You hear me? So, you have to apply exactly the same correction charge as if it was the charge defect. So you have applied the so-called image charge correction and also the bound alignment correction. This is usually the two ones I apply. And when you compare, when you calculate the self-wrapping energy of the polarons, you subtract the energy of the polaronic configuration to that of the delocalized one. But in the energy of the delocalized one, usually I only apply the bound alignment correction and not the charge correction, because the charge is not localized.
But what do you do when you when you have your fractional charges? Then when you want to have a linear behavior, so then you need to include the charge correction for each value of fractional Q, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So I think it's worth mentioning it because it's not absolutely. Something that is automatic.
You are right.
So there is a bunch of questions on the chat. So Xavier asked about how can you guess the initial deformation you apply to your system?
You mean the initial guess of
polaron. Do you distort the lattice manually?
To simulate one?
The small polaron.
Yes. Okay, so if you want, this is what I explained. If you want to put your polaron on a given atom, the atom you have chosen, your atom and chosen your orbital, you have two possibilities. Either you make manually the good distortion that will allow the localization on the atom you want, or you apply the two-step procedure I have described, in which you have nothing to apply manually. This is systematic, in fact.
Okay, can you switch your camera, Grégory?
Sorry.
I really don't want to see you.
Yes.
But it's so much better when... Okay, so I think, but how do you guess it when you said the first possibility? You guess the one that would induce the localization.
Yes, well, if you want absolutely to use the first possibility, so manually, well, usually, if your polaron is a hole or electron, you will displace the cations or anions in the good direction following the sign of the charge. And this is much more difficult to select the orbital, obviously. So this is why this two-step procedure I have described is very useful, I think, to simulate the small polaron exactly on the atom and in the orbital you want. And you have nothing to do manually.
Right, and there's one last question about from Michel that was reading the input variable list, and the documentation say that DFT plus U can only be used on D and F orbitals, not P. Is it true or not?
No, it's not true.
So the documentation is outdated.
I think so. I don't remember. Maybe Bernard can say. I confirm that I have used DFT plus U on P orbitals of oxygen.
So, okay. So, yes, some beautification in the input variable is needed. And Bogdan is asking about the creation of a tutorial.
A tutorial? About what about?
About polarons.
There is no tutorial about polarons, but why not?
Are you working on it?
I'm not, but why not? It's a good idea.
Okay.